Hi, it's Tammy. Thanks for joining. This one video is going to be about reacting versus responding. And the reason why stress and managing your stress is so vitally important for not just yourself, but for the planet. Okay? So the one thing that I do know is that the motivation to change has to come from within. All right? So if we are being told we shouldn't be stressed about something because it's not good for us, most people would be like, I can't help it. I breathe, I smile, I exercise. We have all these things that we're doing to manage our stress. Take vacations, take a day off. There's all kinds of things that everyone is doing, but to say don't stress is probably one of the lamest things we could say to one another. To say that stress is a killer, well, yeah, there's plenty of evidence to that effect, but most people would argue that, well, their family history is that this disease is, part of their grand. Dad died of this, mom has that. So we look at our family lines and try to say, we're all destined to be sick, more than likely, and we're all definitely going to die, right? But I don't want to get morbid about anything here. I'm just proposing that there's a different way to look at this. Okay. So besides telling people not to stress and the objections or the arguments as to why we shouldn't stress and people defending that they're doing everything they can not to stress, I want to go a little bit deeper, okay, and highlight what stress does for us. I want to really talk about the benefits of stress. And really get to how it is affecting us on a cellular level. So if we go back historically and say that we have been exposed to many different situations, and animals chasing us, way back when, that would create these fight or flight reactions. Through these reactions, the body adapted itself. Plants did the same thing. Other animals do the same thing. It's a way of preserving species in order to survive. That is what nature does. That is the beautiful part of nature. A good example I have of that was there was a documentary I was watching once on, I think it was trees in Africa that were being munched on by this herd of, I can't remember the beast, the animal that was eating them. And over time, people were going into these areas and they were finding these dead animals, and nobody could figure out what in the world was going on. We thought there were pollutants. And so the scientists went in and began to study what exactly was occurring that was killing these animals. What was killing these animals? Well, to condense it all down, it was the plants that were killing the animals. The plants adapted themselves in order to protect their extinction, protect them from extinction. And so they generated these toxins that were poisonous to the animals and were killing them. It's a great example of one organism that did what it needed to do. It adapted its very structure in order to protect its future. This is what the human body does. Okay? So when we live under stress, I mean, I'm going to back it up a minute. When we are stressed, there's a series of reactions, internal reactions that go on within the body in order to get you into action and protect you from the external situation. Okay, so you have internal reactions generating external reactions. Okay, now let's look at that over long term, chronic stress, all right, where it's just like we're worried about the bills, we're worried about the exes, we're worried about somebody who's in the hospital, we're worried about our grades, you name it. Whatever stress that you've got going on, and you, all these reasons you have for being stressed long term are actually causing adaptations. Your body is having to adapt to keep up with the chemistry that it's producing to preserve you, because it thinks there's something seriously threatening you. All right. Now, these adaptations, each one of us has about 10 million different genetic adaptations. Some of them are malfunction, you know, some of them are actually causing malfunctions in this moment. Some of them are not. And when I say malfunctions, I'm talking about a misuse of nutrients. All right, that's really what I'm talking about. So let me just rephrase that. Any genetic adaptation that is actually causing problems is simply not using the nutrients that you are taking in properly. This misuse of nutrients creates a chemical that the body doesn't need. Okay, it's creating a different chemical. All right, and that new chemical over time is inflammatory. In other words, it produces inflammation. All right, so now you think about stress as an inflammatory reaction to the world. Okay, you feel inflamed, somebody pisses you off, or you know, you're aggravated by some Facebook post, or you know, somebody's been attacking you verbally, you know, in an email. Whatever your situation is, whatever the inflamed reaction is, it's actually having the same effect inside your body. Therefore, you have inflammation building up, all right? And until you find a way to generate a more thoughtful response internally, you're going to continue to generate these inflamed responses, and you're going to continue to generate inflammation throughout your body. What is the one thing that they talk about with regards to disease and disorders? Mind you, I refer to those as hyphenated words. So if you've ever paid any attention to anything that I've written, I will not, you know, they're hyphenated because disease and disorder is a lack of ease and a lack of order. However, so when we have this lack of ease and we have this lack of order within ourselves, most doctors, I think, in fact, all doctors will tell you there's inflammation involved. Okay, so pain involves inflammation. Okay, cancer involves inflammation. Diabetes involves inflammation. If you have a mental issue, there's always inflammation. Okay, so to combat this inflammation, it's going to take a lot more than using a diuretic. It's going to take a lot more than using essential oils that help reduce inflammation. It's really going to be about combating stress on a number of levels, beginning with how you think about it. And I want to say before anything else, that is a lot easier said than done. So what do we do? I mean, yeah, you can open up an aromatherapy book, and I mean, for that matter, we all know that we could probably list off oils that we are aware of that are soothing, right? You know, there's lavender, there's that one. There's, what's another one? Melissa, also known as lemon balm. Chamomile. You know, you've got two kinds of chamomile. How about some other soothing ones? Well, we have sandalwood. We have cedarwood. Lemongrass. So these are all things that we know if you open up, like I said, you open up an aromatherapy book, they're going to tell you that are soothing. Rose, jasmine, neroli, very calming and soothing oils. However, they're not all meant for everyone. And I want to start with lavender. And I'm not going to go through all of them, but lavender has a lot of major concerns as far as my perspective is, from where I come from. Lavender is estrogen enhancing. If you're using true lavender, which means it'll cause higher than normal estrogen levels to be produced. And if you have a problem with metabolizing estrogen, in other words, if you have breast cancer or prostate cancer in the family, you're best to avoid real lavender if you actually know the source of your lavender and it is real. If you're using lavender in other products, oftentimes this lavender is of a lesser grade, of a different version that has different constituents in it. And it is actually a neurotoxin that can lead to seizures. So lavender, if I was going to say right here and now, is not an advisable oil for many people, including autism, because autistic people are prone to seizures and they also have other chemical imbalances, you know, that an elevated estrogen level is the last thing that they need because it would cause a lot of irritability, agitation, and with regards to the stimming and the excitability and, you know, the emotional outbursts, it's just not a recommended oil, whether you're using true lavender or one of the lesser expensive versions. And it's interesting because when we talk about stress, that's the first thing we want to do is we just want to calm down. And even though you may breathe it in, or apply it and feel the calmness, what you have going on underneath everything is the other chemical reactions occurring in the body. So, as I mentioned earlier, each one of us has approximately 10 million different genetic adaptations. And depending on which one's leading to a disease or a disorder, remains to be seen. But no matter what, a disease is merely a misuse of nutrients. And the more we react to our world and to what we think is stressful, the more genetic adaptations that are occurring. There may be some that are silent that we're activating. You know, you just don't know. And I know that I'm saying that there's a lot of unknowns when it comes to our genome. However, and so how do you select an oil? Well, you have to take the whole picture. You have to look at how you're actually, what other factors are going on with you. Melissa is another one I mentioned. Melissa is not recommended for everybody because it can cause excitability. Even though it is a soothing one, it can cause excitability. It's one that I actually love, but as an essential oil, not as an herb, but as an essential oil, it can create that problem. German chamomile. I do want to point out that particular oil is metabolized in the liver on the very same genes that metabolize a number of medications. And what happened, and what it does is it's an inhibitor. So what that means is that it inhibits the function of that particular gene. Now, what's the benefit to that, right? I mean, why do you want to inhibit? Well, if you understood the way medications work as well, a lot of these medications, like I said before, these medications are designed after what they find in plants. So essentially, medications are here to replicate our plant findings. So the purpose to inhibiting a particular enzymatic process is to maintain blood levels, right? So German chamomile, as on its own, works really, really well. It's very, very calming. It has an antifungal effect, among other things. But it also inhibits the very same gene that a lot of medications inhibit. And so what you end up happening is that the blood serum levels of these medications increases, which, depending on which one it is, it can cause excitability. Even though, so now you have a soothing oil, depending on what else you've got going on, what else you're consuming, you can actually create an excitability and have the opposite effect. So there's some examples as to why choosing your oils as needed for you is really very important. However, that said, using the right oils and helping to regulate your neurochemistry and your hormone levels so that you can begin to respond, so that you can actually provide your genes, your DNA, with more accurate instructions. So it actually begins to pick up the right nutrients and it produces the right chemistry. Now, am I trying to eradicate stress? Oh my gosh, no. You know, when your life is threatened and there's reason to be stressed, you absolutely need stress. It's more about being able to regulate your thoughts and being present to, here we are back to the power of now, being mindful of what's actually going on in here, right? I was involved in a conversation just earlier this morning, and it was not in a direction that I wanted to engage in. Now, my typical behavior is I want to defend my right, okay? I want to defend my what my beliefs are, because this person has their own beliefs about certain circumstances in the world, and I have a different approach to it all. That said, I want to defend my beliefs, right? As anybody would. However, this morning, I actually noticed myself feeling really aggravated. I was feeling really angry. I was frustrated. I was frustrated because I knew that as soon as I put my mouth up, I wasn't going to convince this individual of anything other than their own. You know, they wanted to be right about their beliefs, and I wanted to be right about my beliefs. So I felt the stress creeping up. I was getting really, really, really aggravated. However, instead of even saying anything other than, I don't think we should have this conversation, because this isn't making me feel good. Now, he thought I was saying, you know, I just don't want to talk to you. And what I was saying is, I don't want to talk about that particular subject, because I have my beliefs and you have your beliefs. And that's exactly what I told him. I said, you have yours, I have mine. And what I do know is I am feeling myself spiraling downward, and I don't want to go there. I don't want to feel the aggravation and the stress that these two different belief systems are creating in me. And he actually understood that. And the conversation went in an entirely different way, in a very much a far more peaceful way. But I was able to nab my stress like that. Okay. Would it have been a good thing for me to get engaged with it? I don't believe so. You know, so it's learning how to pick and choose your stressors. So when I say regulating neurochemistry with essential oils, I'm really talking about helping you be more in touch with your body and more in touch with what feelings, what emotions are coming up, and beginning to actually consciously choose your battles. I mean, we hear that all the time, pick your battles, right? Some people just, we react so quickly, you know, we don't even stop to think about if that battle is even worth it or not. Everything at that point is worth it, right? If you want to be right about protecting your own beliefs, everything is worth fighting about. And we are a survival of the fittest. We all believe in protecting ourselves. It's our right. I mean, here we go back to, you know, that's what the human species does. That's what plants do. That's what animals do. We all protect our preservation. So when we add oils to our daily regime, mindfully add oils, purposefully, deliberately select our oils that's perfect for your genome, you actually bring in the component of self-regulation, a whole nother level of self-regulation, and beginning to not only just choose your battles, but actually giving yourself permission to be stressed. Because stress does protect you, but it's a more mindful approach to stress. I don't know if this is making any sense. Like I said before in my introduction, everything that I provide here is completely unscripted. And I'm happy to provide, you know, any sort of written information. And in fact, I probably will follow a lot of these up with written dialogue so that you can go back and reread it. But I really want you to understand that if you have any questions, please comment below. Please email me for more specifics on yourself. And I'm always available for personal consultations. Like I say, if I had any desire in this world, that is for everyone watching these videos to find it within themselves to empower their wellness and take wellness back. Reclaim your power. And begin to mindfully choose your future. Nobody has to be a statistic. So when it comes to stress and it comes to reacting versus responding, it begins on the inside. You know, some people talk about, and I really believe the external world is a reflection of our internal world. If we see chaos and conflict, it's a good representation of what's happening. It's the disease and the disorder within us. The chaotic turmoil of chemical reactions that's occurring. These are the things that we can actually get a grip on and alter the way we interact with one another and the way we interact with the world. So please, by all means, ask questions and let me know what you think about this and how this might benefit you and how I might be able to continue to serve you. So thank you. And have an absolutely beautiful weekend. Bye-bye now.